So just so that members can understand, there are 17 car parking spaces in this rectangular area. And at the top of the site, there are a further four here, and the new clubhouse is proposed to be located in this area. So the provision of a new clubhouse forms part of a wider strategy to secure its long-term future. Former Lairds Sports Club was located on the opposite side of St. Peter's Road, but was considered to be no longer fit for purpose and has since been demolished and the site redeveloped with residential units. Proposed development is for ancillary facilities supporting the principal use of the site as a playing field and would not affect the quantity or quality of the playing pitches or otherwise affect their use. The building would be single-storey and set back from the road. It would be some 15 metres from the rear elevation of properties adjoining the site on Proctor Road. However, the building is single-storey and would have no habitable roof windows that would result in any overlooking. The original proposals were amended, reducing the height of the building by 0.6 metres and reducing the footprint by some 50 square metres, together with the relocation of the entrance doors to now face St. Peter's Road. These changes were introduced following concerns raised about potential for noise disturbance. The condition is also proposed that restricts hours of operation for clubhouse and also the associated car parks. It's considered that the benefits of securing the long-term future of a club that has been well established in the area for many, many years, together with the conditions proposed on the application, if approved, to minimise disturbance to local residents, we're in favour of supporting this proposal, which is for approval. Again, there is a qualifying petition for rejection.
Is there an absence of the petitioner's presence? If you could come forward and...
So for those people at that end, they would be looking out upstairs of mice. We have had a lot of mice in our houses and in our lofts. And we also feel that when you start with the planning permission for this, which also involves getting rid of two or three large blue containers, that we will have mice back again. What it means to us, the residents, is the noise. What time is this club going to be open till? What are the hours? It's noisy enough with the football match. We can't even get our own cars in because they're parking on our roads and down the side. There will be air pollution and car fumes. We won't be able to sleep with the back windows open. All we're getting is the car fumes. So it's noise, lighting, petrol and car fumes.
You have 1 minute.
Thank you. Also, with the vast amount of money that Cllr have made, I believe it was £775,000 that the original land was sold for, are they going to do anything along Procter Road with the horrible blue railings? Because along there is needles, glass, cans, rubbish, and that's just on a normal match day, especially when there's a coach along there. Summing it up simply, no consideration for the residents that actually live there. And we also feel it would also devalue our property for those of us who do want to sell the property and move on. That's what you'd be looking at the back of our houses now. So thank you for the opportunity.
Are you happy to take any questions?
I'll try. Yes.
Do any members have any questions for objectors? Thank you for your presentation.
Thank you.
Is a representative for the applicant present?
Social club and behold, seat up to three or four hundred people. acceptable. It's maybe not ideal place for a football ground, but it has been a football ground since many of us can remember. I was never talented enough to play on it, but I have been there to watch matches. And we then have to sort of consider the overall intensity of activity that will be there. It is very much going around match days that will be activity on such a level, maybe the occasion. Going at the scale of the clubhouse, it's not going to be big enough to have, you know, to maybe the odd hiring or conference room stuff going on. And my view is that if we were to sort of project this going back to what it was and when the Cammell Football Club was successful, I think the impact will be less. If you think of it, it will be less than it has been in the past. So my view is that if you have a football club, you expect certain and certain things to go with it. If you have a successful football club, Cammell play, I think, the North West Counties Division at the moment, then you expect something to go with it. And as the resident says, it's a well-established community, it's a well-established use. There will always be, you know, issues in and around, things like that, and any relocation probably makes things feel worse than they are. But I'd like it to be the committee to take a balanced view of what's gone on in the past and the surrounding area of where we are. And I think it's a reasonable application for a football club to exist and to continue to exist and hopefully become successful. If we become completely successful, we have to move off that site anyway because we have the constraints of it. So my view is that overall, in terms of Wirral and its picture of what we want to be, I think it's a positive application rather than a negative. But I accept entirely the anxieties of the neighbours who have to live there.
I don't think any reason that we've accepted Mr. Fathers' football picture. I think the concerns that have been outlined in the report from the officials and the Mr. O'Neill is the location of the car park. It's disappointing on a site of this scale that the car park is so near to property in church news.
It's right under the bedroom window.
So I think I'd like to hear from the Environmental Health Officer if they can in terms of any additional measures that could be put into place or be not to condition this application or any additional reassurance that will come to residents if this application is approved tonight. And to ask Matthew Paradovis to advise what the situation is in terms of notification of this meeting to residents, because that was named, I think, or mentioned by the petitioner in her initial remarks that they were in this public meeting tonight. Clearly, we want to notify people of meetings because we're webcasting, so presumably we want to audience, so we can tell what the procedure there is, please.
So in terms of notifying for the committee, we will notify the lead petitioner and only the lead petitioner. So if the lead petitioner has an email address, then the notification would have been emailed to him or her. If they didn't supply an email address, then it would have been sent out by post. And that is done only after the agenda is published, because obviously reports can change up until the time that the agenda is published. In terms of and of course the website is updated, and I know that the data committee was available for anybody to see leading up to Christmas, because that's when the reports for the Lairds committee were finalised. In terms of wider consultation as part of the planning application process, and I think this is what Mrs. O'Neill may have been alluding to when she was talking about a site notice. We send out notifications to anybody who has a common or shared boundary with the site. So anybody who has an immediate boundary with the application site would have received a neighbour notification. And depending on the nature and scale of the application, we may then put up a site notice or even a press notice in the Wirral Globe. But we have guidance that's contained, that all of that is contained. There's statutory provisions which we have to comply with, and then there's the council's own guidance which is contained in our publicity guidance, which again is available on the website for anyone who wants to see.
Any other?
Sorry, Environmental Health.
Thank you, through you, Chair. We took notice of the fact of the condition that the car park was shut in sort of 2.5 hours early with the clubhouse at 9 o'clock. Traffic movements to and fro
I'm sorry, I know I'm not meant to shout out. We already have the bus depot there. We've got all those buses.
With pollution. With pollution. All day.
Why couldn't you have the car park there and at least they would be together?
Well,
why? Give me another one. We've already got the bus depot there.
I guess we can only determine the application we have in front of us, and we have the constraints of the sites. It's not clear to me how they could introduce a car park in any other location. Really, the report does make reference under the highway section to the current issues that are experienced, and again was referred to by the objective in terms of on-street parking during match time, which has been of concern. I've also noted that some yellow lines are to be, some junction protection is to be put in place for purpose of highway safety. Whilst the introduction of an on-site car park might not alleviate all the congestion issues on street parking, it may very well do some. I doubt that it will attract new traffic because the people that will go out to watch towards the games will be the people that go. Is there anything we can do about boundary? I've not noted any boundary treatments adjacent to the between the car park. If we were to ask for trees or something like that, that might also help people residents' approval, particularly if it blocks out sunrise. I think we can only decide the application as it stands and on the merits of the application that's been put in front of us. That being said, any other contributions or should we? I can't. I'm afraid to think of a valid reason for refusal. I'll move approval from the chair.
I'll second the chair.
Can we see those in favour? Open to members then, any points?
of it is on the green belt, I believe. That's the reason why it's here. And my view is that it's generally a positive application for the
Well, I would agree with some of
Steve's comments, but not all of them. There's a distinct difference between the last application and this one. This one, as far as I'm concerned, doesn't back any harm to any houses and doesn't cause any unnameliness for anybody. The last application, I thought that was quite against the back gardens of those houses. The lady that spoke was very
eloquent.
I want to allude to the previous application to Steve Hampton in the first instance. So I just wanted to justify those of those voted against.
I'll refer members also to the supplementary agenda and their additional amended conditions under additional condition for the creation of a wildflower area, which I think is very positive for our friends in the beach community. I'll move approval if the seconder. Thanks, George. And see those in favour, please. Is there a representative of the petition?
need to highlight and that have not been resolved. The first one is that there is not enough car parking provision in the various towns. So there is some concern within the village that this will lead to parking on a very busy road and within the village itself. This is less than satisfactory with the volume of traffic that passes through the village on a constant basis. If this venture were to prove popular as Claremont Park, parking could prove a major concern. The second concern is the access. I note that highways have no observations to make, which is extraordinary. The entrance and exit, as shown on the plans, would appear to be quite dangerous. I think both David Ball and David Rees, at the site visit, commented that it was not ideal, as there could be an issue with coaches turning right out of the entrance. This could have serious implications for the general flow of traffic passing through Brimstone Village. I also understood that there would be a plan to install traffic calming measures. Can you tell me if this is so? If approval is recommended for this application, but until these two serious applications are addressed, can I ask the committee to vote against the application, please?
Any questions from members of the council?
Accidents there and that visited this site itself in the past and the moment is quite sick in getting them out of there.
I'm not aware of any accidents that's been there, but it is quite difficult to get in and out of the into the courtyard there, yes.
But we'll put that to the highways engineer as well. Any further points?
Fair to say your only comment was that many of the anxieties of the residents have been met by the conditions. I don't know what words around it. Is that a reflection why many haven't turned up tonight, or is there any other reason you can think
of? I have no idea why they've not turned up, but I've certainly been approached about those two specific conditions. I mean, things about the preliminary dig for archaeology and everything's been met. I think some of the objections have been covered in those 17, is it, conditions that's going to be attached to it. So that's possibly why, and you do know the parking and the entrance and exit have been raised as serious.
Thanks,
Okay, well, perhaps if we put that, was the issue of accidents as well.
Yeah.
Yeah.
There's no evidence to suggest that the proposals would have an adverse effect on road safety or the number of accidents in the city. We have asked for a condition to relocate the 30 miles per hour speed limit gateway boundary, which is to the east of the proposed access, and also for the applicant to provide two electronic vehicle activated traffic signs as well.
It's probably just worth saying that when the application was originally submitted, Councillor Bowen would be aware that the original car park was proposed here in the orchard, which obviously would have had a greater impact on the green belt and would have resulted in a significant loss of trees in the area. So the plans were amended to put the car park here. There are 54 spaces there, and as Carl has already indicated, it does accord with our supplementary planning document on planning standards, parking standards. So.
Okay, thanks.
Yeah, a point we've made about the possibility of coaches causing an issue regarding access to the house and premises. I was wondering if the Howie's absolutely agreed that's a possibility, and if it was, could we stipulate that they all had no coaches signs or such times the access is okay? I don't know if it is or not.
We could do that, or we could ask the Highway Engineer whether the accesses are suitable in terms of the. We've seen these things modelled for supermarkets, but whether the access as planned is suitable for HDB and coach access.
The proposed access at the forwards, the wall handings which is shown to the east there, is 5.5 metres, and then the access road is maintained at 5.5 metre width throughout into the complex, so it could accommodate those sort of movements, but there's no coach parking bays proposed as part of the development, and as Councillor referred to earlier, there are other establishments across the borough where we wouldn't normally sort of generate those sort of coach trip movements to like Church Farm, Thursday's and Glen Farm.
Well, I mean, look, this is a cracking little set up to be on the bridge as well. It's one of our hidden gems. It is a gem that I'm very proud of. To the point of back when, I keep saying this, but when I was mayor, I did take a coach trip there because we had five mayors, four of us, and their partners, and but we took a coach up there. Coach drivers are amongst the best drivers in the world. Their livelihood depends on being safe. If we may as well close down roads and tourist attraction, we start putting no coach parties around. If this becomes an attraction where the old coach arrived, I think surely that can be accommodated. Our driver basically took us in to Corkhill, dropped us off, and then took the coach to their safe and said, I'll be back in half an hour. So there's ways around this thing. I'd hate to think that we would be developing tourist attractions and then say people shouldn't mind the coach. Because there is a package there, actually. Coaches will do a little mini tour, they do brim stitch, they do port sunlight, they do a little tour around the shore, that's what we're about, aren't we? Get this growing the tourist industry rather than put barriers in the way. What better sort of statement that a farm shop on a farm selling produce? It's like going back in time, isn't it? It's what used to happen. You always used to go, if you ever been camping, you go and get your bag of your eggs and your milk from the farm. To me, it's what the industry is about, and I think it's a positive. You know, it keeps always looking for negatives on this community. Perhaps I'm going to use
chance here to spread out from where they've been found, because there is no way this was confined to one little field. This is spread out. It could go from Easton up to Woodchurch and right away across Wirral. We have a chance in this borough to attract tourism in for a heritage trail and even UNESCO World Heritage status. And I think we should be seizing the opportunity to do this. We know we've been denied access to this site today. To have a proper archaeological survey would be utterly fantastic in my view. And I hope that we can preserve what we've got here for future generations.
Well, don't go and catch whatever you do.
There will be another planning committee in the function that has regard to a such a battle test.
The council, I believe from Paul Sator on Monday night, the council has logged or is in the process of logging this with Battlefield Trust.
Is there someone else in the country that belongs to Battlefield Trust?
This is an application that seeks planning permission for the erection of a 1.8 metres high close boarded fence, replacement entrance gate, sand and cement rendered flank walls to the Blakely Road entrance, and retaining walls within the curtilage of the dwelling. The application is retrospective. The close boarded fence has been erected at 2.4 metres high. If the application is approved, then the applicants have agreed to reduce the fence to 1.8 metres in height, which is considered to be less detrimental to the character and appearance of the area. The condition would require the reduction to be completed within 4 months of the date of the approval. In 2004, planning permission was approved for side and rear extensions to the property.